Mutation. It is the key to our evolution. It has enabled us to evolve from a single-celled organism into the dominant species on the planet. This process is slow, normally taking thousands and thousands of years. But every few hundred millennia, evolution leaps forward.
A-B-N.
It's headphones, Neil! What's up, guys, and welcome back to another episode of Headphones Neil Reviews. I'm your host, as always, Headphones Neil, bringing a review that I've been meaning to do for some time in the form of mashing up the six live-action X-Men films into what I imagined in my head as a coherent story to see how well the stories, in fact, line up with each other. Does any scene duplicate itself? How is the acting and general cohesiveness work by watching them all together? So the film watch through order that I did was X-Men First Class, X-Men Apocalypse, the 2000 X-Men, the original one with Patrick Stewart, then X2, X-Men The Last Stand, and then round it out with X-Men Days of Future Past. And for the most part, the story fits well together. You have the introduction of all the key characters, namely in Professor X, Magneto, Wolverine, Storm, Mystique, and all of those. You have the battle lines being drawn, and over the course of the films, you kind of have them working their way into the relationships that you know them from. So, for example, Storm and Cyclops and Wolverine joining up with Professor X, Mystique and Sabretooth, and all those people teaming up with Magneto. Magneto's origin story was as far as where he came from and the chip on his shoulder and all of that. So in general, the story works well together. The main thing for me that didn't work or felt kind of weird but actually works in retrospect is the origin story for Magneto. So when he was in the internment camp, X-Men First Class actually presented that story very well as far as why he's so angry, the creation of why basically the story of how he is worked well together. But then when you see it again at the beginning of the 2000 X-Men film, you would think that it's actually a repetition because that's the origin, but they actually present it less, but it actually serves well in that film as far as why he, at the end of X-Men Apocalypse, is showing hope with Professor X, but then in 2000's X-Men, why he's, again, back to his old tricks and why he's lost faith in humanity. So while it's not necessarily well presented, it actually feels like it was supposed to present or having that introduction at the beginning of the 2000 X-Men is meant to show his fickle nature, and that he, because humanity is the way it is and it's hard to keep hope alive, that he is the downside as far as losing hope and not being able to hang on to it. X-Men Days of Future Past shows that in Professor X, and they present that actually well to the point where it feels like they learned from not presenting it well with Magneto, that Professor X has lost hope. He doesn't want to teach or lead anybody. He doesn't want to be a mutant or use his powers for anything. He doesn't want to be a professor and have his school. So Wolverine and the old man version of Professor X have to tell him that they need him to hope again so they can survive their future and not send Mystique and Magneto down the path that they went to ultimately create the Sentinel program and mean the end of their race as they know it. And it's more than just his feelings. There's a lot of mutants out there who can't take care of themselves, and his school provides that safe haven for mutants to learn and grow and generally just have a place to live where they're not judged for being a mutant. So that's the overarching story. So I would give all of that a grade of about a 90%. The biggest thing that stands out is as far as the downside is the story of Nightcrawler. So by the end of X-Men Apocalypse, we do have the introduction of young Nightcrawler, and he's not brought back until X2, but then it's almost as if Jean Grey and Storm forgot about meeting him in X-Men Apocalypse. So as far as Storm goes, that can be forgiven just because Storm was originally working with Apocalypse and shows up at the school to be one of the good guys or good ladies at the end of the movie, so she potentially didn't meet Nightcrawler, but then Jean Grey did meet him, I guess, and they were on the same plane together when they were leaving the wreckage of dealing with Apocalypse, so she would have remembered that they met him. So it wasn't really explained well why they didn't see Nightcrawler for all those years, and it's one of those things where I guess you're supposed to figure out that he was being brainwashed and he disappeared for some reason. So why he disappeared or why he was all alone in the church is hard to explain. And it would have been one of those things if they had known about him or if there was some sort of explanation at the end of Apocalypse as far as why he was no longer with the X-Men. So that kind of stands out as one of the downsides of X2, or at least the Nightcrawler character, but in both cases he was presented well, so the actor and the acting for the character were not poorly done at all. They were actually very good. I like that. So all in all, good stuff. So that's really all there is for this particular review. I was glad I was able to watch all of them. They're actually all streaming currently on Disney+, so if you do want to go back and watch them, see if they hold up in your opinion, then they're definitely worth watching. For me, it was good watching it in this order just because it felt like a nice cohesive story. I originally thought by watching Days of Future Past after the original trilogy would not work, but it's one of those things that because they involve time travel and they're kind of dealing with two potential futures at the same time, that could have also been an issue, but it feels like they handled it well where or simply by having Professor X or old Professor X talk to young Professor X and deal with all of that, and then having the young cast and the original cast with each other, and then also having Logan return at the end of Days of Future Past generally just works because they tie up all those various story elements, so it does feel like they were trying to stay as or keep the story as cohesive as possible between the two trilogy of films. So for me, it overall works. The thing that definitely did not work for me was the whole Dark Phoenix storyline. So originally, I don't remember having a major issue with it. I thought it was an okay film, didn't think anything of it, but then I've been going through a rewatch of the 97 X-Men cartoon, and I noticed that they didn't really deal with that as well as they could have, especially with the ending of X2. It felt like the Dark Phoenix story at the beginning of Last Stand would have been a major overarching story as far as dealing with the mutant cure and providing for a better story than just hatred for mutants. So they could have started the story with Jean Grey as the Dark Phoenix, potentially trying to go after the president again, or going after maybe Bolivar Trask, and then because of that he decides to team up with the other scientist guy, and then they create the cure, and then they fast forward to the rest of the film and deal with that. From there, I guess the rest of the film, I think, could have worked out fine as is. Just, it didn't feel like they gave the Dark Phoenix enough time to breathe or give us a reason to care why or how the Dark Phoenix is powerful, aside from just showing us that she can lift a bunch of cars and that Magneto and Professor X tried to block that from her mind. So that, and then at the end of the film with all the fire, I actually thought I remembered more destruction and flames and fire going on, but then in watching it now, it felt like there was just more basically it was like the Jean Grey was backlit by the fire rather than having the like CGI fire and flame around her or something along those lines. So in general, that whole part of the film was not well presented, even though that was countered with a good portrayal as far as the dealing with the mutant cure, Rogue, and her dealing with it. So that's kind of why, probably why I felt the film was only okay, even though I didn't realize it at the time. So for me, that's kind of the setback. So is the other piece of why I only give the six film franchise a 90%. Most of that 10% loss is because the Dark Phoenix was not portrayed well, even though it could have been. I didn't actually have a problem with Sophie Turner's acting as young Jean Grey. The guy who played young Cyclops was the same guy from Ready Player One, so that was a nice little bit of tie-in there. So overall, I want to say that the films work, and I would recommend watching it in that order. So to recap that, so it was First Class, Apocalypse, original 2000 X-Men, then X2, The Last Stand, and then Days of Future Past. So in general, all of it works. So just keeping in mind that the introduction for our introduction for young Magneto at the start of the 2000 X-Men is more to show that or foreshadow the end of the film or later in the film when he's not or he loses his hope in humanity again. And that's countered in or that's resolved in Days of Future Past with the Professor X of why he does still have hope in his discussion with himself in his mind through Wolverine. So that's all there is for this particular review. So if you have any questions, comment, feedback of your own, or anything like that, you can find me on Twitter at PatelN01. The website is headphonesneil.reviews for past episodes, subscription links, supporting the show, and all of that good stuff. And of course, if you are a patron of the show, you are getting the second beta episode for this week alongside this public release for everybody. So if you want to check that out, see what's going on the beta or for the beta episodes, and be sure to support the show on Patreon at patreon.com/patelN01. But that is all for this particular episode. Thanks for tuning in, and until next time.